Yeah.
Hi, everybody. This is so fun and weird, I know, for us to be here together. Yes. We just met for the first time out in the hallway, and we have mutual friends. It's such a small world.
It is. Like, I know her brother, and my writing partner from the comic books is one of the Desiree's friends and a director that she's worked with a lot.
Yeah, Mark Evanier.
Yeah, in fact, the first time that I saw Desiree was actually on Garfield documentary that my friend Mark was working on.
Wow, it is a small world.
It is.
And Patricia and I were talking about how we hardly ever, I mean, she doesn't know me at all, but of course she wouldn't, because Danse wasn't on as many episodes. She was the star compared to me, and I remember that voice just booming over the top of my head.
But how many people would Wally have in the room when you guys were recording? Do you have like six people or stuff? Because that's a lot of stands to not get
sometimes
recognized.
All of us.
Yeah.
He would cram as many as he could. If you needed a crowd scene.
Oh, yeah. Because, like, I remember when we were doing X-Men, we had everybody in at once, and that show had a huge ensemble cast. So, like, we had 12 people in the room, and the mic noise was just unbelievable by the time you have 12 people with scripts.
Yeah. Right.
Just the jostling stuff. But I agree with Wally. Like, when you do an ensemble, it's always better than when you do sides.
It is. It was a very different experience for me working with that cast as opposed to working on the Garfield shows, because in Garfield, Mark Evanier, they wanted everything to sound very, very much like we were stepping on each other's lines. We might be, perhaps, in favor of doing what the director wants you to do.
Well, and also, like with Garfield, Mark had the advantage of he was the producer and head writer, and also he was the voice director, and so he was protecting his own script. Where Wally was protecting somebody else's script that he didn't have autonomy over.
Good point. We could chit chat all we want, but we're really here for you, so what would you like to hear about?
Yes.
Well, I'm sure that Patricia has plenty of behind the scenes stories, more so than I might.
Oh, I'm trying to think something really clean. You know, behind the scenes, basically, we would just be off in the green room, and we would be talking, or eating, or drinking, you know, drinks.
They always have snacks there for us, yeah.
And cracking jokes, and talking about Jenna. And, you know, she comes blimey here, she comes flying in. No, she's not here. I remember she was just so young. Now I can talk about her. She was so young and like, you know, like
We were.
I was older, but she was really young and just like off the boat. And so was Samantha. Samantha's another baby. Is it more?
I remember the day I auditioned for JemCon. I was very excited to do it because I'd been pretty much immersed in Garfield and Charlie Brown land. I can't remember the year. Who would know the year that we would have started production?
Oh, 84 we auditioned.
Okay, so I had done
85.
Betty Boop by then, maybe? I think
yes.
I'd done Betty Boop also at that time. So really, I still considered myself a musician, a singer-songwriter, who just sort of stumbled into the world of voiceover acting. By being asked to be that incidental voice that would come and go in the studio when I was working on Garfield. I'd always be there when the recordings were being done, and because they were recording songs that I and my partner Ed Bocas had written. And so they would say, oh, we need girl number three. Des, get in here and do girl number three, you know. By being asked to be that incidental voice that would come and go in the studio when I was working on Garfield, I'd always be there when the recordings were being done, and because they were recording songs that I and my partner Ed Bocas had written. And so they would say, oh, we need girl number three. Des, get in here and do girl number three, you know. And so I would do that, but then it wasn't until I'd auditioned for Betty Boop and got that someone said to me, you know, you really probably should also consider yourself a voiceover actor by now. And I had done Nurmal too, but again, these to me were sort of little, you know, sideline things to my music, which was. So that day when I went in for JemCon, I had done some by that time, but I thought because it was about an all-girls rock band, I really thought I was going to sing. I thought that was the audition, was singing. And I walked in there, and they handed me the sides. You know, they call them sides when you're going into audition. It's just a portion of the script. And I think I auditioned for every character Did you too? I mean, they had me on stage read for this one and that one and the other. They had me read for you. I remember that because they kept saying, you don't sound angry enough and gutsy enough. They said, push it harder, harder. We want it harder. And I couldn't do it.
You were hungry.
That's great.
Oh, by the way, on the technical side, when we talk about sides, what it is one side of the dialogue. It's just the character's version of what's happened. Like as a producer, director, you get a batch of cassette tapes and you'll get a list of the names in sequence. And it's just the most heartbreaking, cold-hearted process where you just have to go and you listen to four different people do the part and you go, oh, he's out, she's out. Oh, I kind of like that one. And you get it down to where you got the two or three ones that you like and then you send them off to the client and of course they pick somebody you didn't like.
Yeah, so I went in there sure I was going to sing. Samantha had that same impression. She thought she was going to sing too, I think, when she first auditioned. And I kept waiting for them to ask me to sing. And I even finally just said, I guess it was Wally, I said, so when do you want to hear me sing? He said, oh no, none of these characters will be singing. None of you guys would be singing. No, that'll all be done in New York. But I do sing. That's like my main thing. No, you'll be a voice person. Okay. Oh, well.
Was it huge?
It wasn't huge, no. Was it huge when you were the
Yes. Nurse? Oh. Yes. See, when I went, it was a cattle call, but because Wally was auditioning, everyone was backed up. You didn't go in and just do your lines. You did your lines 8 times and then 3 other characters 8 times. So that's why it all got backed up. And by the time it got to me, you know, like there's tons of people, and tons of people, I'm telling you, with names. I mean, real people who were there, and I'm like,
yeah, back in the day, so she was already a voice artist.
Oh,
and so,
yeah. Oh, yeah. But I mean, she was already, I mean, we're talking about actresses.
But
yeah.
Wasn't she, like, kind of finished, like, 10, like, 20 years, 25 years ago, she was already kind of finished?
Honey, they finish as voiceover actors, and they keep on going.
The good thing about being a voiceover actor is that your physical appearance doesn't matter, you know, like, and you can particularly see it with the men. Like some of the men with the most handsome voices are really kind of a little trollish. but yeah, because they have the big barrel chests and things, they have that deep resonance in their voices. And they're great voiceover guys, and they wouldn't have the same effect as live action actors.
I went to an audition once at LA Sound.
I don't know if it's still there, but that's.
What was it? A commercial, something. And I walk in, and I'm sitting there ready to read for something. And I look, and who's sitting on this dungeon, you know, this was Charlton Heston.
Wow.
Did I not do the same thing? I was like a poem about it. And I was like, Moses? Me? Ready to audition, and here's Moses, like, sitting across from me, waiting to audition, and he's like, his hair's a little, like, I'm like, and I thought, oh my gosh, you know, and you have those moments of, like, oh God, the ghost of a future, like, is this what it's going to be?
Yes.
You start.
No, I only sat across from Charles.
I bet I can top your story.
I'm sure you can.
Well,
I did meet Lucille Ball once, and that was a thrill. Both she and I were on a panel, much like this, at the Museum of Broadcasting, as it was opening in L.A., and they were paying special tribute to her and to Charlie Brown. And I was brought in as the guest panelist to talk about the music and what the signature sound of Charlie Brown. And so there we were sitting together, and she said, you know, you're really a cute little thing, and you're way too young to be here, which was a real compliment. And then when she heard my name, she said, you know, my middle name is Desiree. I said, really? I didn't know that. Did you know who read it?
Yes. Andy Hayward, the evil leader of Geek, is a genius of marketing. And so he put an ad in the trades, wouldn't you like to help save the planet? And he invited celebrities to come in and audition for roles on Captain Planet. And so as a result, we got people like Meg Ryan and James Coburn and Whoopi Goldberg, and just all kinds of celebrities showed up. But the thing that broke the bank for them was when Tom Cruise phoned, and Tom Cruise wanted to be Captain Planet. And so we started the show with Tom Cruise as Captain Planet. He recorded 6 episodes, and I started working on Days of Thunder. And it just wasn't working out, so both sides backed out of it. But my favorite Tom Cruise story, and this is one of the reasons why, even though Tom Cruise has some troubles with the press, I actually think he's a decent guy. Like when he took the, and it just wasn't working out, so both sides backed out of it. But my favorite Tom Cruise story, and this is one of the reasons why, even though Tom Cruise has some troubles with the press, I actually think he's a decent guy. Like when he took the part, he came to the studio to meet all the creatives on it, and besides the head creative, I got to hang out and give him the studio tour. And when you're at a studio, the management is always worried when you take the celebrity down into the zoo with the artists and the writers, because things can go crazy and bad really fast. And so I was just trying to keep everybody on a short leash, and I would take Tom Cruise around.
Main guy, and he was just really gracious and wonderful, and wore like man clothes. And just like, you know, really, it was just sweet, and I went, wow. Because he just, it was the timbre of his voice, which was so lovely, because it's so deep, and it was like,
speaks for life down here.
It was nice. Just fun.
Yeah. I had fun with him on Captain Planet, too. And as it turned out, he had been working on the It miniseries about that time. And as it turned out, they were filming in Seattle, and my old friend Rick Hobart, who was like one of my fellow board artists on G.I. Joe, Spider-Man, and all those shows, was a storyboard artist on it. And so we had Rick's stories to tell each other. Before. And so I told the operator, I'd like to speak to somebody doing action-adventure shows. I understand you want some comic book guys. She goes, well, who would you like to talk to? And I go, I don't know, whoever's an action-adventure show guy that would like a comic book. She goes, well, how about Doug Wilder? And Doug Wilde was the guy that created Johnny Quest, and he'd been a comic book artist back in the 40s and 50s. And so they put me through to Doug Wilde, and so by chance I got through to Doug, and Doug was a great character, and he was just horrible to me. And I go, well, I did comic books. He goes, oh, well, why didn't you say so? And then he invited me in. And so I went to Los Angeles, and thanks to Mark's kindly intervention, I had interviews that day at Hanna-Barbera, Ruby Spears, and I think Golden.
Oh,
Press,
wow.
And all three of them offered me things. I went with Hanna-Barbera just because I wanted to work with Doug Wilde, because he was one of my heroes. And when I went into Doug's, why didn't you say so? And then he invited me in. And so I went to Los Angeles, and thanks to Mark's kindly intervention, I had interviews that day at Hanna-Barbera, Ruby Spears, and I think Golden.
Oh,
Press,
wow.
And all three of them offered me things. I went with Hanna-Barbera just because I wanted to work with Doug Wilde, because he was one of my heroes. And when I went into Doug's office for the interview, he had this stack of presentation boards of the storyboard of the Godzilla title on his desk, and he asked me, what would you like to do? I look at the storyboards and I go, whatever that is, that's what I want to do, because it was just cool. And he goes, well, I'll let you do storyboards, but you have to do layout first so you know what you're doing. And so I started doing layouts where you do the big drawings of the characters. And Doug and I hit it off, and so he, true to his word, he started giving me storyboards. And I wound up being the first new storyboard artist, Hanna-Barbera.
Now, it wasn't acting per se, but I was on camera, and I learned an awful lot about production. By the time I was finished, I actually left the show as they were starting to run out of money. I saw the writing on the wall, and I had some other opportunities, which I'll share with you in just a second. Actually, yes, doing a story on the Aborigines. I was out in the middle of the outback in an Aboriginal reservation, is really what they were called. Sadly, and still are. And there I was, somebody came running down the dirt road saying, Desiree, you have a phone call. And I said, what? where, what? And they said, there's a phone like half mile up the road, a pay phone, and someone's calling you. I said, really? Okay. And so I went up there, and there was a phone hanging, hello. Well, it was the executive producer of the U.S. Sports Show, who happened to be Lee Mendelson. Many of you might remember that name from Charlie Brown. And he said, hey, you know, I know you're stuck there in the outback to write music. And I said, yeah, I love to write music. And he said, well, you know, my songwriting partnership for the Charlie Brown shows is kind of, they're going through a relationship thing. And he says, I've got a show that I've got to turn around pretty quickly. It's called No Man's Valley. And it's for NBC, and it's about endangered animals. And would you, if I FedEx you the script, you know, would you look at it and maybe write some songs on spec for CBS? And I said, oh, are you kidding? I'd love to do that. So we were then, the crew, he had gotten the number through my field director, field producer, and that's how he knew where to find me. So anyway, I found a little honky-tonk bar in Alice Springs. There were cobwebs all over the piano. I cleared the cobwebs off the piano. I had a Sony Walkman with the recorder on it. Sony Walkman. And I read the script, got inspired. So anyway, I found a little honky-tonk bar in Alice Springs. There were cobwebs all over the piano. I cleared the cobwebs off the piano. I had a Sony Walkman with the recorder on it. Sony Walkman. And I read the script, got inspired, wrote 5 songs that afternoon, recorded them on my Sony Walkman, FedExed it back to them, and by the time I was done in Australia and came back, I was meeting with the head of specials at CBS at that time, and that launched then me as someone to write music for animation. And from then, right on the heels of that came the first Garfield special, for which I penned the theme song, Here Comes Garfield, and also So Long Old Friend, just off of reading that script. It was an awesome first script, that first special. And then from there I went to, then I was partnered up with Ed Bogus. So anyway, I found a little honky-tonk bar in Alice Springs. There were cobwebs all over the piano. I cleared the cobwebs off the piano. I had a Sony Walkman with the recorder on it. Sony Walkman. And I read the script, got inspired, wrote 5 songs that afternoon, recorded them on my Sony Walkman, FedExed it back to them, and by the time I was done in Australia and came back, I was meeting with the head of specials at CBS at that time, and that launched then me as someone to write music for animation. And from then, right on the heels of that came the first Garfield special, for which I penned the theme song, Here Comes Garfield, and also So Long Old Friend, just off of reading that script. It was an awesome first script, that first special. And then from there I went to, then I was partnered up with Ed Bogus.